Okay, let's get started. Good evening, everyone. We are PMI Romania, the host of this event, and we are very happy to see you again, some of you. It's been a month since we met last time when we finished the springtime project management marathon. Now, just to keep our momentum, we thought that three new sprints could bring us the opportunity to address fresh and relevant topics regarding project management. The first sprint is called Project Management in the Digital Economy between Sustainability and Social Responsibility. And it will be presented by Dan Besleaga, an old friend of PMI Romania. Before starting, let me remind you that the event will be recorded and will be accessible on YouTube. During the presentation, we prefer, most of us, to switch webcam and audio off. Please write any questions you might have in the chat window. As usual, we can stay a few more minutes for further conversations after the presentation ends. Thank you for your patience. And now I invite Cristina Dragomir, PMI volunteer, to introduce today's speaker. Cristina, please take over the mic. Thank you.
Thank you, Cristi. Hi, everybody. I am Cristina Dragomir. I'm a PMP certified project manager, and I was adopted as volunteer by PMI Romanian chapter's team. I'm happy to join this event tonight and introduce Dan Besleaga, whom I personally treasure. Dan is the perfect fit for a mentor's job. He has a valuable experience and knowledge and shares the stories in a comfortable and familiar way. We are partners in project management course at ExecEdu, and I attend to his classes as a big fan of his methodology and commitment towards sharing. Tonight, Dan will share with us his view about project management in the digital economy between sustainability and social responsibility. Looking at the project as the vehicle of change into the new digital economy, we need to redefine the project success factors and maybe the project approach itself. Within this business world, where performance is defined on three pillars from now on, financial, sustainability, and social, we need to adjust the criteria of what means success for projects to come. Additional non-functional requirements like environmental and social impact on the project will extend a set of constraints toward project objectives, as well as introducing opportunities of higher standards in future economy. The balanced scorecards, KPIs of this new business triangle, financial, sustainability, and social, are translating project teams into a much broader stakeholder environment, which with much broader implicit requirements and expectations. Best practices from various dimensions like industry, environment, and behavior are merging into new standards. All knowledge management areas are impacted, from scope definition, new risk approaches, and quality standards, through teams diversity and extended stakeholders management. Outcome of projects should carry information related to how much carbon dioxide produced in atmosphere as deliverable itself, or as part of a larger process, and how is improving the diversity through project methodology. This is an area of reflection where all project management community is already part in order to build the future by changes in sustainable way. So let's hear Dan and the call to responsibility.
Yeah, thank you very much, Cristina. I have to say that I already have a better opinion about myself after such an introduction. I really appreciate for this good mood that you bring, yeah, for the speaker. Yeah.
Thank you.
Hello, everyone. In the call, it seems that we are around 20 already. So based on the introduction done by Christina, makes no sense to add too much in addition. I want to share already my screen. Just let me know if screen, do you want to continue? Yes, screen sound and my presentation share. Also, a very often question that you have these times, do you see my screen?
Yes, we can.
Yes, we can.
Okay, good. So now we can start. Why I took this approach of such a subject is not new. All of us, we know that this topic of sustainability, it's quite old, mainly from the Greenpeace activity from the second half of last century and so on. But the reason why I brought in our slot today is the following. I use, beside my training activity done in the Exekedu, I do have, responsibility in an organization of a company named SAP, where I'm in charge with delivering projects all over the markets, between Atlantic Ocean and Indian Ocean. So I'm leading a so-called nearshore center, having about 500 consultants in SAP application solution responsible to implement this business solution over this territory, mainly. Yeah, could be also beside of them. Starting with last year, I have to say, much more aggressive in the agenda that we have day by day, I've noticed the following trend. That customers are asking us to bring value not only on the performance, the economical performance that they gain implementing our solutions. They are asking us to share with them what are the best practices in order to reveal what are the benefits of this approach, what are the good things that we can bring with our solutions related to the environment, related to the social impact, related to the trust that the customers are able to gain implementing such a solution. Yeah. So this is one aspect that started to come more often in the daily agenda. Yeah. The second trigger is coming from the company itself. It's pushing us to implement a lot of initiatives related to sustainability, related to the standards that we need to implement within the organization in Romania, in the link with the standards of ISO 14001 or this kind of sustainability in terms of waste management, of energy consumption, in terms of carbon emissions, and so on. Yeah. So we do have a direct pressure internally, not only from external. And the third trigger that we have is the fact that we in this business, we are running a bet each year. We are running the bet in which we need to invest in order to build skills for the near future, for the next 5 to 10 years, yeah, in order to develop consultants with such skills to bring value in which topic. Yeah? And we discovered that based on the market trends, we need to adapt our skills in order to position also what it's already built in the company's software as sustainability products. So actually any business process that is implemented is requested to add information related to gas emission for this process, related to the consumption of energy of that process, related to the even to things related to diversity and inclusion of linked to that process. A lot of indicators that have not been in the past. So that's why This topic comes to my table day after day in a more, let's say, imperative way. What I want to share with you is what is my experience, what is my agenda, what is what are the issues that I face in my daily life as a consultant specialized in project management, with based also on the experience of all my colleagues involved in projects. We do have around 200 projects in our portfolio in each year. Yeah, and to introduce you in the concepts that I've collected through some literature review, some research, yeah, and to set up the context where we want to establish what means sustainability in project management, yeah, and to face what we measure, what kind of KPIs we have established, what are our intentions for the futures, and also what are the trends that we perceived from the markets from this perspective, from the perspective of sustainability, no matter if this sustainability is related to environment or social or the people ones. So let's define a bit the context, the overall context, and here it's good to start with the main reason why we are as project managers. We are supposed to be the change agents, like Christina has said in the beginning, in the abstract of this presentation. From the abstract of this presentation, we are the changing agents. Yeah, we are representing the change within with our projects, within organizations. Yeah, and we're supposed to do a better world with these changes. Yeah, all these changes represent the project, and the outcome of this project is supposed to have recorded a development from the past. What means sustainable development is defined as a development that meets the needs of actual generation without compromising the need of the future ones. Yeah. So this is the definition done by World Commission of Environment in 87. And in my opinion, it's very clear what we're supposed to understand with this sustainability, what we can done, not compromising the future generations, not compromising us in the future. At the end of the day, is about surviving of species, and this is surviving of human civilization. To have a common understanding on the global level of this sustainability, I consider that it's good to start from what United Nations consider to be the sustainable goals on the planetary level. And they have identified 17 such goals, most of them linked to people, very much of them linked to environment, and very few related to economical, as you can see. So except the ninth one, industry, innovation, and infrastructure, most of the others are related to people and environment. So because why? Because the economical itself is sustainable itself to grow in terms of how to obtain profit, how to be more performant in this aspect. The thing is how we can protect the planet, how we can protect the people. And this is how the topic itself can be named as three P's, yeah, planet, people, and profit, to define the entire world of sustainability. Here, going a bit down to project management, I have to share with you that after my literature review in this topic, sustainability and project management, I realized that most of the materials that I found in the last 3 or 4 weeks, I have to say, are touching the most important paper that have been built around this topic, sustainability and project management, written by Silvius, I suppose it's Georg Silvius, I don't know exactly, I have to check. Is the professor in Utrecht University in Netherlands with some of his colleagues from there. And he wrote a book in 2012, Sustainability in Project Management, and also have a lot of various materials in this. And he selected from the whole set of what is, say, sustainability, he selected a set of, I counted here, 8 areas, how we should consider as project managers this topic, sustainability, and what we are doing there. So first of all, sustainability, for sure, it's about the balance. It's about equilibrium. Yeah, it's about the balance between social, environmental, and economic. We are doing mainly projects to have an economic impact for the business, or if it's for public sector, for sure we need to do it for social and environmental aspects. Yeah, but the balancing between them is supposed to be the topic that is day by day in our agenda. The second approach is related to the link between short term and long term. Yeah, what is the impact on short term? What is the face of what is the impact of the our deliverables on short term and on the long term? Yeah. The third one is this mix between local and the global. Yeah, because for sure, what could be good in local terms could be not so good in global terms and vice versa. Yeah. We are reaching very fast the topic of waste elimination with waste management. And here I realize reading all these materials and going through the certification that we have passed a couple of years ago with ISO 14001, that the waste management, it's something very profound, very deep. Yeah, and I realized that we need to take care also in projects about this waste management, and we never measure this waste based on the project based on the project performance. Yeah, for sure, when we are talking about sustainability, we need to involve the and to have committed all the stakeholders involved here and all the stakeholders that are needed to be involved here. Yeah, doesn't matter if you are direct connected to the project or not. A very interesting point related to sustainability, it's about consuming income and not capital. So this means that we need to take care to consume only on what we can have as an income, not what we can borrow or we can have as a loan. Yeah. The seventh one, it's about transparency and accountability. Here is a very important topic, mainly related to stakeholder management and communication management. This I've already perceived this in my activity and in my colleagues' activities, that it's increasing a lot the workload and to do this transparency and to prove that we are accountable for all what means sustainability. At the end of the day, when we are talking about sustainability, we are talking about ethics and values, yeah, because these are the values that counts for our lives. Yeah. So the idea behind this, the outcome of the Silvius book is that all these 8 elements will come to be in the PM book as well, in the body of the PM responsibility, and also on all the deontology. Okay, sorry. The conduct guidelines of the project managers. In 2008, United Nations came with the new deal named Green Economy. Yeah, so they were able as a global organization to gain all the participants, all the members from the United Nations, and to put on the same table, to have the same commitment about what? About reconfiguring all the business and infrastructure that deliver this business, yeah, that are running in order to provide the benefits for nature, for human and economic, yeah. But to do this, how? Reducing the greenhouse gas emissions, extracting and using less natural resources and creating less waste, having in mind that we need to reduce social disparities as well. They have done these initiatives as a whole program with a focus on 11 areas or industries that you can see on the right side of the slide, starting from agriculture and sustainable cities and ending up with the tourist and waste management. Yeah. So all these programs, at the end of the day, it's the major source of projects that are driving the projects that we will be involved in the future, in the near future, in the long-term future. Most of the organization all over the world, doesn't matter if are public or private, supposed to align to this program and to take the main coordinates and the main dimensions of this sustainability from this initiative. And all of this topic related to sustainability has to be driven through a certain way how we are performing the value now in the economical environment. Because what we are doing, all in the private sector at least, we are looking to create the profit. Yeah, to create the profit indeed in the most sustainable way as possible, but to create the profit. And now, looking to how the whole human civilization have been developed from 12,000 years ago when the civilization was established, yeah, till now, we have been based on technologies. And looking to some studies, there are three categories of technologies that are driving the new future for humanity. Yeah. One, the first one is about information technology, including communication for sure. The second one is related to materials and energies, so real physics and chemics behind. And the third one, it's about genetics, yeah, biology behind. Yeah. So these three, let's say, directions of development, new technologies are are expected to be the main drivers for the future of the human being. Looking to the first one, it seems that it is the most generous in terms of opportunities that can come on our daily life. Yeah. And this digitalization, yeah, information technologies is transformed now, it's a kind of digitalization of the whole economy and the whole life, not only economy, yeah, also our social, all of us are used to use technology and all our lives are transformed through this technology. All our relationships, the relations between people, friends, families are changing through this technology. This process of transforming to digital, it's called digitalization or digital economy. It's also called internet economy or web economy. At the end of the day, what is digital economy? It's the same economy that we have done, but we are dying with the digital tools, with IT tools, with application, with infrastructure from IT, yeah, and communication. And not only this, because there are different stages of digital economy. I'm in charge. I'm responsible with my team to implement digital solution for our customers. Yeah, but it's not only about implementing IT, it's not only about automation through IT of some certain processes. It's also about bringing new technologies like artificial intelligence, like Internet of Things, like big data and big volume of data, also blockchains and all these new technologies to add new value to the customer business environment. And this is driving to a more than a digital economy, is driving to intelligent enterprise. And we can say we can get in much more deep from here. The sky is the limit. Yeah, my intention is just to define this digital economy and the fact that more or less all of us are working in it. Yeah, more or less all of us are bringing new value and are developing and are bringing the innovation with digital tools and create digital economy for the future. Yeah. looking to the values of digital economy, it's supposed that about already, if I remember correctly, in 2018, so 2 years ago, the last data that have been collected on the global level, about 35% from the total digital economy have been owned by United States, and 15% by China, yeah, and 25% by Europe. Yeah. In the meantime, I'm pretty sure that China is increasing a lot, and also all the others, but China with the most dynamic one. The value of digital, of this digital economy are thousands of trillions. Yeah, it's a significant part from the total economy, and for sure will increase this share from this total economy. So this is the environment that we are working to do our projects. And the pressure is coming now from It's coming from the past, but now we have to do it. We have no option to escape from this, from sustainability. I've also discovered from my literature research that we can set up what are the major categories of projects that we are expecting from this sustainability pressure that we have on the global world. And I've realized from a material written even from a co-national from Romania, Professor Carmen Ciocoiu from ASE, that there have been perceived three major sources of projects coming from sustainability. First category is falling into the group for upgrading existing business, for doing existing business differently, to do it in the more sustainable way. So this means that we need to decrease through our projects, we need to decrease the defects, the direct effects on the environment, how we are doing the production, how much pollution we generate with this production, with the operation, with the distribution of the goods. Yeah. Just to give you an example, a couple of days ago, I have listened to RFI, the radio station, being on the car, spending my normal 1 hour from the office to the house. For example, L'Oreal, I suppose, was, yes, L'Oreal was the company, have mentioned that they are thinking to change the entire distribution chain with transporters only with electric cars. Yeah, so many of these suppliers on multinational levels, and think about L'Oreal, it's mentioned that they have reached in each year at least 1.8 billion houses. Yeah, so to change all this supply chain and distribution chain with electric vehicles is quite an impact. Yeah. So this is how I call switch to sustainable, what is old and how to be transformed. So a lot of transformational projects, programs are supposed to come from here. And I can bet that some of you already are working in this. Yeah. The other source is related more to innovation. It's related how to create from the beginning a sustainable way of creating deliverables, for creating products and services, yeah, using the digitalization, yeah, in this green deal done on the global level. Yeah, here we are talking about designing the entire supply chain, manufacturing, and the relationship with the customer, or the to cash a lot of processes, yeah, plan to product, procure to pay, yeah, all these processes to digitalize in a such a way to reduce the waste, to reduce the pollution, and to reduce the to increase the wellness of the entire humanity on a decent level. Yeah. And the third one, which is more difficult as a source of projects, more difficult in terms of measuring the quality of implementation, it's about the mindset. This is what I've realized thinking to how my colleagues are acting, how myself I'm acting in relationship with it. What is my what are my habits in relationship with this. And there is a need for sure to change these habits. Yeah? I need to change it on my age, yeah, over 50. I need to change, to help to change this, helping my colleagues, younger colleagues, to adapt a more healthy one. Yeah, and here it's a source of projects, very sensitive ones that maybe is, will be difficult to address other than in a very agile mode, let's say so. Yeah. So these are the sources. This is how the projects will come, in my opinion, for the near future. So this was the overall context. Yeah. In terms of what means sustainability, what means digital economy, what are the main drivers from this? Let's go a bit down now and go to the business itself. Yeah, how the companies are running in the future, how the public organizations supposed to run, what are the expectations from them? Yeah, because at the end of the day, we are running projects in the name of an organization. Yeah, no matter if it's a public one or a private one. Yeah. So for sure, is no more valid the fact that we just need to generate value with our projects in terms of financial outcome of the investor. Yeah. It's not enough by far. For sure, the expectation from the project outcome is to balance very well the business, the economical benefit with the environmental one and also with the social one. Yeah. And I start to see a lot of indicators coming on top. In the past, when I did my, let's say, management studies, this was in the 80s, in 2000, beginning of 2000. Yeah. I used to work with tools related to balanced scorecard. I don't know how many of you used like that, but at that time it was supposed that all KPIs, all key performance indicators, in order to prove that the respective organization is healthy and will be there also in the next 5 or 10 years, not only now, cannot be judged only on financial results. Yeah. At that time, it was a case with a company named Enron in the top 500, which suddenly was bankrupt. And all the consultant companies like B4 ones was assessing with 1 year before that the company is very strong and so on. But only 1 year was completely bankrupt. Yeah, I don't know how many of you remember that event. Yeah, and it was very clear that only financially is not enough. We need to take in consideration also customers' portfolio. We need to take in consideration know-how portfolio, what are the licenses, what are the new innovations licensed there, how you are knowing to do things, you know, the know-how. And the fourth one was related to growth, to culture of growth, yeah, how the people, the employees, how the culture into the organization, it's allowing the growth and the innovation. Yeah. And all these four elements supposed to define the healthiness of a company. Now it's not enough. Yeah, bringing with this topic is not enough to provide only KPIs only in these areas. We need to add. We need to improve either the knowledge and culture or to add additional two or three topics in this balanced scorecard. And these are related to the sustainability, to the finance, beside the finance one, with the environment one, with the social one. And even after only 1 or 2 years, now we have, you have in front of you a study done by IDC in the material names Future Scope 2021, Creating Sustainability Digital Economy in 2021 and Beyond. They discovered that it's not even enough to balance only between finance, social, and environment. You need to add also topics related to trust. And this trust is very, very sensitive. This is, I already have a bit of experience, let's say, in getting trust, starting also from my sales experience or from my project management experience or from management experience. Yeah. So to deliver trust in the relationship, it's one of the most difficult the part of the story, you know, of our existence on the earth. And based on what is expecting from a company now, with all what you see there, financial purpose of environmental and societal, the trust, the ecosystems, the entire relationship that you have with the partners from either suppliers or customers, and also to prove that you have diversity and inclusion, inclusion with a lot of topics that you see that are becoming, we consider to become too politically correct, but it's a reality that we have to accept it and to adopt it. All of these are creating a future organization, a future enterprise. And all these demands are transforming projects for us. All of them. The type of projects that you can see here, for example, the future of work, I do expect to be completely different from what you delivered in the past, or the future of operations or the future of intelligence. So I see a completely changed paradigm, what kind of projects we're supposed to deliver in the future. Not disruptive. I still see a continuity for what we are delivering now, but from where we are coming and where we are going, the future looks in this kind of colors. And our responsibility here, it's expected to increase dramatically. I also see a perspective of this digital economy and the trends that we have also in a negative way. I can recommend, strongly recommend, and I can already show you 2 minutes only, I suppose. Just 1 second to share 2 minutes video. Let me just 1 second, new share. Share computer audio, share. I hope, do you hear and you can see?
And it all started in merry old England, of course, you know.
Do you hear this and see the movie?
Yes, we can hear. Yes.
Okay, good. Just 2 minutes here.
Around Birmingham and so on. And the column, you see the 1780 down there at the bottom. And now you see London, the London column growing here. So London, where you burned a lot of coal because we had no wood anymore for heating the house because the forests were cut down. And now you see how the Industrial Revolution spreads across Europe. So Germany was second and Poland. If you think of why are the Polish so stubborn about coal, they were actually the pioneer of using coal. And now you see on the British Isles how the columns are growing. You see Paris growing. Finally, you will see Berlin growing. You will see nothing in Italy, only a little bit, but it will come along soon. And you see the global emissions. Now we turn across the Atlantic, and you see New York City. You see Chicago. And you can pick your favorite city in the United States and see how the emissions grow. These are cumulative emissions. So you see 5,000 megatons CO2. Now we can watch Tokyo growing on the other side of the planet. And now we are going today, now we're going into the future and see how the planet is developing into a carbon hedgehog, actually. So we are in 2030 now, 2040. This is business as usual. And you see what is becoming of this planet, and it will end in 2100. So this is more or less the complete decarbonization of the planet. It even includes Africa, not in the same way as England and so on. Is this our fate? Is this our future? Well, I show you what...
Okay. Coming back to to our presentation. Yeah? Do you see now?
Yes, I can see.
Okay. Good. So the speech was done by Hans Joachim Schönhuber, who is the Director Emeritus in Potsdam Institute of Climate Impact Research in Germany, near Berlin. In my opinion, it's one of the most with the high impact on the audience. It's a physician, and I just saw, I suppose half a year ago, from one of his material. I strongly recommend to watch him on the YouTube. He already proved that with this trend that we have, we will never have a new ice age. Yeah, it's the first time that we are getting out from the predictive of the ice age, because the level of CO2 is taking out from anything that it's already proved with a formula. Yeah, model it for the last 12,000 years from the beginning of the civilization of the human being. Yeah. Also, you can see here at the bottom of this slide the name of him. Yeah, in this YouTube, it's in a relationship with Aurelio Pacel. And he mentioned also here that with this digitalization, we do also have a kind of 3D perspective: environment degradation, social disintegration, and disruptive digitalization. And for sure, within such a three-dimensional context, you can have a negative narrative. Yeah. You know, when you can see the environment is degrading, we can easily fall in the attitude of save yourself, we can, yeah. And we can easily, we can say, to be honest with ourselves, that we are in the area of consumptions. Yeah, we used to buy even things that we don't really need sometimes. Yeah, and we generate a lot of waste with this. It's called Amazonization. Yeah, taking from Amazon. From this is how Joachim Schönhuber is taking the term. With disruptive digitalization, he mentioned that. We have more and more people now, younger generation, taking days off, like weekends or vacation days, to be alone in their virtual reality. And it was mentioned in the material, the trend that they have identified in Japan. Yeah, the people are willing to take off 2 days from partners, from families, from friends, for even from the employer, to be alone with the real virtual reality. Yeah. And for sure, we can imagine what will happen if we are going with these trends. For sure, we can create also a positive narrative. Yeah. And here we have to work. So this means that our projects are supposed to work and to adopt all this all this teamwork that we have to do, all these goals of the innovation that we are doing, yeah, to build a new level of humanity, to build a new way of creating empathy, yeah, because in virtual reality we cannot expect to have empathy there. What are the pressures that we have within our projects in terms of deliverables? At the end of the day, if we are working in developing new products or upgrading products or creating new services, I don't know how many of you are measuring the level of waste, but I realize in the past I knew that for one track of final goods, we have to have 29 tracks of waste. I've discovered that in the meantime, the percentage of waste has increased. So actually we used to to manipulate 500 billions of tons per year as natural resources, yeah? And from all this quantity, we obtain only 1% as final goods. All the others are wastes, yeah, 99%, which is is by far not sustainable for sure. We need another planet in the near future. So that's why there is a huge trend of going from linear economy to circular economy. Yeah, what means this? Means that from what is linear, taking the raw materials and the inputs like energy and materials, and go to production distribution, use the product after that disposal of that respective product, and at the end to become a waste, go now in the circular economy, yeah, which we have been using the communist time, I have to say, for those that are much younger than me. We have been used to have this kind of mentality, and now it's brought again on the table that we cannot survive without. Yeah. What means this? Means that we need to think twice what we want to buy, what we want to build, what we need, how it looks our products, and we need to think what kind of attributes have these products supposed to have in order to be repairable, in order to be reused, in order to be, and what is the supply chain that you have to ensure for this. So this way to the final good brings out a lot of challenges. Yeah. Looking at the end, based on the same study from the IDC, yeah, where we need to act, here you can see very clear that for sure most of the companies are starting to measure and to improve their carbon footprint. Improve means to decrease it, yeah? And it comes more often in the discussion that we've had with all my colleagues in the industry, yeah? Also, there is a huge change in the HR era, in the HR topic about the new generation that will supposed to work for these new companies that are running, for this digital economy, yeah, that we are running. Artificial intelligence will become a must. Yeah, it's already named to be the fourth revolution in the industrial era. Yeah, but will come by default with the new technologies in this digitalized environment. Also, this need of speed and the need to bring the data instantly from wherever it's happening in the world to wherever is needed to be analyzed, to take a decision or to give an emotion if it's needed. This data supposed to have even the private 5G networks. Yeah, so there are a lot of designs in the new organizations, indeed with the capacity they can afford, to install private 5G networks. Yeah, to connect all these things through Internet of Things and to with all layers of security needed in order to build trust, to provide a more sustainable business. So these are the trends. All that you see here have been selected as being the major trends, at least in Europe, for how will look the new economy and from where our projects are coming. How is reflected in the project management area? Based on this is the source is Van den Brink, but the source is the same sustainability for project management book that I've mentioned before. The trend is to switch from what we are now in the modern project management environment to more sustainable project management. As you can see here, we need to embrace in our stakeholders analysis, in all our requirements analysis, in all what means risk and quality assessments, we need to embrace also the local society and global society. So the responsibility that is falling on our shoulders are increasing dramatically. Yeah. In the past, I'm coming from the initial one, from the traditional project management. One project manager was responsible for project objectives, and sponsor was responsible for business objectives. With the more modern project management, these things was melt, was somewhere in between. Yeah. Now it seems that the project manager becomes the new manager of creating the new world. Yeah. So this is what I've seen here, and for sure our best practices as project managers supposed to include all the key performance indicators that we have linked to social responsibility and then environmental responsibility, at least. If we can bring also in terms of trust, the better will be for any of us. Yeah. Thinking about how it's impacting what we are normally thinking in project management, in knowledge management areas, I've identified that more or less all knowledge management are touched by the sustainability requirements. Starting with the scope management, where for sure we need to enlarge the requirements analysis and the collection of the requirements. Even go to schedule management, because we need to address these new requirements, changing maybe from the predictive to adaptive methodologies, to be more agile, to be more flexible, yeah, to include the flexibility in this schedule. Also, the cost management is not only costs anymore, it's the waste management also here, it's about gas emission management, a lot of management of resources supposed to be measured in this. In terms of resource management, and if we are talking only on human resource management, the diversity and inclusion will be the must. We need to prove with our selection of team members that we are indeed bringing the right diversity of the project in order to bring the right value, in order to bring the right social responsibility, yeah, and to help the society to go there. Yeah, remember the first goal from the United Nations was to no poverty. We creating our team projects, we need to be open enough to think about how we can sustain this. In Romania, for example, we have to agree that at one moment in time, we have been much lower in terms of income, in terms of our ability to deliver. But due to the fact that the Western civilization was able to adopt on within the European community, within the NATO, yeah, we have been able to increase and deliver on the same level of expertise, on the same level of quality, yeah. And now our income is increasing dramatically compared with where I have started. 20 years ago, I have been paid with $200 per month, yeah. We are far from here. Yeah, from 200 euros per month. I've just realized, I just noticed that we have been now passed to the fourth category from the World Bank, which is the highest in terms of income. Yeah, it's difficult to believe, but this is reality. Only 1 billion of people are living in this category. All the others are in the lower one. 1 billion and a half are living in a category with $1 per day. Is difficult to imagine. So we have to conclude here that all our knowledge areas are affected. Yeah. And I see that we are quite, there is a significant risk to delay, let's say so. Yeah. I want to at least to summarize, yeah, that the sustainable project management means from now on, yeah, not only planning, monitoring, and controlling project delivery and support processes, but also to take into consideration all economical, social aspects and life cycle of project resources, processes, deliverables, and effects. Yeah, we need to take care of all of this. Yeah, just to give you the hint, what is expected from our side. First of all, it's about a scope shift. Yeah, for sure we need to enlarge the scope. The paradigm shift is the fact that we have to move from the predictive approach to more agile approach in order to prove the flexibility needed to cover all this aspect, yeah, and the mind shift approach. This is the expectation that there is on the project management area. Yeah, there are some stages, but I will share anyhow the materials. What I want to share with you a kind of KPIs that I measure within my organization that I'm counting on. As you can see here, we are counted on total net carbon emission, and there are different reports on emission per thousands of euros gained from the turnover, yeah, or emissions per employee. Also, what about the e-waste? So the waste in terms of electronic equipment, yeah. Also, the sustainability is related to number of employees, the employee engagement, the net promoter score, the leadership trust. So a lot of indicators are linked to this social responsibility. Women in management linked to diversity and inclusion. It's a very tough topic. That's why you can see that a lot of board areas are containing more and more women. Not just because they're women, for sure, they are very qualified to be there, and they bring a lot of value added. For example, in my short circle, my boss, my counterparts, many of them are women. Yeah. Also, I've noted already about this. I want to close the topic, and after that to share some, to let you to put down the questions and so on. I want to give you three takeaways, yeah, from this session. First one is that we do expect in the very near future a great reset, a reset of the whole economy, how the business are running. All what means reset means that we are there for doing transformation projects, yeah? And this reset, it's first reimagine the business in order to meet the real world priorities now related to sustainability, yeah, and to generate a new sustainable collective mindset. Yeah, so this is the trigger that for sure is happening now and will happen much more dense in the future. The second one is about the project management itself changed in terms of scope, paradigm, and mindset. And the third one is that we need to be aware that all of our knowledge management areas are affected about this sustainability. And I do expect in the next variant of the PM book to be reflected in this way. Yeah. At the end of the day, what we are doing from portfolio, because any organization is having a portfolio, the meaning of it to produce something for the society. We have processes how to do this portfolio. We have skills, yeah, in order to run these processes, yeah, to do the deliverables that are in the portfolio, and we have to go to market. This is the business model for any organization, yeah, portfolio, processes, skills, and go to market. Any of them supposed to be translated in a much more sustainable way within various initiatives, like you can see at the bottom of this slide. Circular economy, climate economy, equality for all, yeah, mental health, and so on. Good. So this was the message that I was willing to give you, and I'm more than happy to see your feedbacks and your thoughts about this subject, how you are affected about this subject, and so on.
Well, Dan, thank you for this amazing presentation and perspective that you share with us. It seems like we are at the beginning of a very long journey, and not so linear that you just show in on the picture. I'm not sure if you are referring the great reset in terms of economy and mindset and or in the political terms. It capture my attention, that expression. Nevertheless, what do you think, which are the most effective incentive for common people like us in order to embrace this new approach to be more sustainable? Because at the end of the day, if I'm not economically motivated to change my behavior, it's very difficult to do this only at the philosophical level. Or what do you think, should we expect for a top-down approach from government level or regional level, or should we start massively changing our behavior from bottom up?
I can share only my experience. I am not someone that can say that this will be done. Yeah, but I can share what I live now. Yeah, for example, in my company, most of the seniors are allowed to have a company car. Yeah, and this is a very significant, to be honest, a very significant incentive. Yeah, it's a kind of competitive advantage. Yeah, for us in. Compare with other companies.
Not for the last 15 months, yeah?
Yeah. Now we have a clear target that till 2023, we have to be net zero carbon emission. Yeah, footprint on organization level. What really means this for us? This means that all the company cars supposed to be electric. Yeah. Is this an incentive? The first reaction, I have to say, was quite negative from the people's side. Yeah, just to be honest. Yeah. Just to give hints from inside. Yeah, yeah. But after just couple of months, 3 or 4 months, they realize, first of all, that the dynamic on the market in terms of car offering, it's increasing so much dramatic that they can easily select a better car in the future than the car with the gas. Yeah, with diesel or gasoline. Yeah. So this is a kind of incentive. It's a minor one, I agree. Yeah, the second one, it's related to all the rewards and initiatives that we have on company level that we are rewarding any social responsibility, CSR initiatives, or related to, for example, we have now something to plant new trees and so on. Yeah, a lot of initiatives are scored in such a way that we are rewarding them. Yeah, indeed, it's not a monetary reward. I fully agree. On the third terms, in terms of promotion, the scale of promotion are going through this sustainability. We are promoting that people that are proving that they can bring additional sustainable, let's say, front of our customer or organization. Yeah. So this is a real incentive, honestly speaking. Yeah, because this is how the world is coming. Yeah. The third one, it's related to the fourth one is related to the how their jobs will look in the future. You cannot do the same thing 40 years in the same way. Yeah, for sure, the story that we have to create for selling our jobs, it's very much related to the link to this sustainability. Yeah, if we are able to bring this story in front of the customer with our sustainable products, with our sustainable way of doing projects, with our sustainable project management methodology, with our sustainable and so on, for sure we'll be a selected one. And this is an incentive.
Yeah, you're right. By the way, I remember the time when a famous company car used to produce so-called car for life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Of course,
yeah.
I'm talking about Volvo. Yeah, car built to last.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, it's not the case anymore. We know what happened during the 90s and after that, mm-hmm. with a very different, actually opposite approach in producing cars, to be okay for 3 or 4 years and then to buy a new car. Yeah. What do you think? Should we expect to come back to a different approach in building even common goods to be more sustainable, not to be encouraged to buy a new one, but to keep mm-hmm. it as it is? Because that means sustainability and removing
yeah.
the waste. But this could imply generating fewer profits or fewer business.
Mm-hmm.
The kind of conflict here.
Mm-hmm. Also, I'm coming to my personal experience from this time. Yeah, I have a son. He is 30 now, and he was very disappointed that I used to spread some chemicals over my vineyard. Yeah. I used to produce my own wine, yeah, and I'm quite proud about my wine, like any winemaker. Yeah, it's nothing new in this area. But he was very disappointing about this, and he makes me quite aware that currently we have only 1/3 of the global life from the global population of beans, for example, due to this kind of spread of plants and so on. Yeah. What I've noticed is that new generation, it's much more aware and much more empathic with these sustainability indicators that we have been our generation at their age. Yeah, so it's I've noticed something that I already checked with my colleagues, younger colleagues, and I realized that many of them are much more aware than myself and only much cautious than myself, yeah? So that give me hopes that we are going in a very good direction, and the new generation is better than us, and I can be very proud about this. So this is the bottom up, as you have mentioned in the past. This is the bottom up approach, and I realize that they have this responsibility and they feel it. Indeed, they realize much more than us that they have not so much time like we had in the past, because we consume that time. They have no this time. They have to act now.
Yeah, you're right. So there is hope, right?
There is hope. You know what I mean? There is hope.
Yeah.
I have the feeling that I am a bit guilty that I consume some of their times with my way of, let's say, consuming goods. Yeah.
Dan, you lived in an era of double-digit growth economy, yeah.
Indeed, yeah.
At any cost, no matter. Now we have to pay the invoice for
exactly. This, right? Yeah, we pay with this. Indeed, yeah. We pay with this.
Yeah, indeed. Okay. Thanks for your answers and thoughts. Let's invite other people from the audience to express their questions or concerns or any other comments. So feel free, you can even to open your video channel, speak up, or drop a question in the chat bar.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I hear you.
Hi, Dan, thank you for the presentation. So just a couple of notes I made during your talk. I wanted to mention, just for the sake of argument and maybe just generating some mm-hmm. new ideas. You mentioned at one point that as people working in organizations, in commercial organizations, we want to create profit. I think I would argue with that it's very limiting view and it's not the only way to view organizations. I think it's much more healthy to think of it as creating value, and value can be defined more than profits. It's about sustainability, including sustainability. It's about satisfying the stakeholders of the business, including employees and so on. Just wanted to make the point. Then you talked about the L'Oreal example with their electric cars, their attempt to become more sustainable. I would say maybe it's a step in the right direction, but electric cars don't mean sustainability. We're just moving the pollution out of the cities into the areas where we produce electricity for now, and the transition for a more sustainable electricity it will take a long time, and it's not even sure how we will get there. Some people calculate that we need too much land to create solar panels or wind turbines to produce the energy we need. And actually what we need to do is start consuming less, be more slow in our moves, and to live a more tranquil life and more local life. The fact that worries me is this, that people keep talking about new technologies and not so much about the sacrifices needed to become sustainable. Switching a car, a petrol engine car with an electric car is not really solving the problem, not even close. And this is my final point, and I will let others join in. Just wanted to remind people about the Enron case. It was not the fact it was not profitable and suddenly become bankrupt. What went down there was a massive accounting fraud. So basically, they were never profitable. They were just playing the books, and one day this all came down. It was in the open. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, so those are my points. Very good presentation, Dan, but I just wanted to add to it if I was allowed.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you very much, Ovidiu, for this. So just we go through, if I remember correctly. First one is related to the first question was related to
about profit versus
about profit. Yeah, you have perfectly right indeed. So all the statements from any company, it's saying very clear that it's about sustainable, yeah, and not only about profit. You have perfectly right. The problem with the profits is the following. In the real life, and especially I can share the multinational setup, yeah, in the real life we have the following priorities. Yeah, the first one, you have to provide the numbers. Yeah, only if you provide the numbers, you can provide the rest of anything else, sustainability. Indeed, you have to design how you are doing the numbers in such a way to provide the anything. When the company starts to be desperate, like have been in the pandemic, and you need to survive, many times the companies decide to do compromises. Yeah, because the profit is the ultimate resource for surviving. Yeah, just to be sustainable but without profits, it's not working. Yeah, so indeed, maybe my words were too direct, too tough. Yeah, you have perfectly right. In the real, anyone is willing to do this sustainable, but in a desperate situation, the priorities are a bit non-elegant, let's say so. Yeah, this is the point with the profit. The point with electric cars. You have right again. Yeah, we are in a story that all of us have rights. Let's say so, like Robin. Yeah. The point here, what I've noticed, because I had discussions with my friends, or let's say on non-formal level, similar with the arguments that you have. Yeah, because indeed, what we are doing with batteries, in order to change a battery, create more pollution than the gasoline itself, and so on and so on. Yeah. actually, it's a bet on technology that the solution with the batteries and the recycle of batteries will come faster, yeah, to reach that circle economy also for batteries. So it's a bet. Indeed, now we do not have a solution, but it's a bet for the future that we will have. For what we have now, there is a bet, it's a certainty that the resources that we have in terms of oil are limited. Yeah, so that's why it's preferred to have this bet. It's a global bet that is playing right now. They have pros and cons, yeah, and like anyone, you can be pro or con, but this is what they choose to be. So this is the way how we supposed to go there. Yeah. And the third one, it's an open topic, that it's open for anyone to to build arguments here. Yeah. Thank you very much. Anyhow, very relevant and real arguments indeed.
Hello, Dan. Bogdan is speaking.
Salut, Bogdan.
Hello. I just want to make 2 points, and I have also one question. The first point, it's about the green certificates. Okay. As we know, all the companies, especially the big companies, have the possibility to buy green certificates. So they are green, mm-hmm. but they are green on the money. So mm-hmm. this is one point. The second point, at the United Nations level, G8, it's a group of UNFCCC, United Nations from Carbon Emission Framework. They established the level of the pollution for each country. And they are receptors and emitters. Mm-hmm. The receptors are buying practically pollution from the emitters. Mm-hmm. And the receptors are usually the unindustrialized countries, which are not very developed in producing energy based on fossils. So this is one point. The second point. My question is, because in the construction industry, I know what we are doing. We are buying green certificates. We are talking about green concrete. We are talking about solar panels. We are talking about imposing photovoltaic panels on the buildings. What are you doing in the IT companies for sustainability as a project manager?
Mm-hmm. Very good and tough question, yeah. Yeah, so I can tell you what are the incentives and the KPIs that I have now, yeah, related to this. So first of all, we have a guidance in terms of any IT equipment and how we're supposed to treat it in order to be green, as you said, Bogdan. Yeah. Second, now we are started to have measurements in our systems for any process, how much gas emission we have per process, not per employee or per company. So we want to allocate like a cost center, yeah, not only the money needed to run a process, but also what is the gas emission related to that process. And we are expecting to come also in projects and to measure our deliverables and our project performance with these kind of indicators. So we do expect that this will be the next KPIs set that we will receive in terms of sustainability. So for production, for all operation, normal operation, it's already in place this. Yeah, now it's going to projects. Yeah, this is what we are doing. Yeah, in terms of the technology and IT itself, for sure, the highest expectation are around artificial intelligence in order to increase the low consumptions from one side of the processes of the software, what kind of optimization you can do to decrease the consumption of energy per process. Yeah. And on the other side, from the hardware perspective, to develop new technologies with low carbon emissions and so on. Yeah. So there is a mix. Yeah. What I've noticed is that actually all developed societies are developing policies in order to create incentives for nations and for organizations to work into this direction. For sure, we have ambiguity. For sure, we have discrepancies. Yeah, maybe we do not yet have a meritocracy in these terms, but we want to build it. And this is the right way how to do it. I cannot see a better one, honestly speaking. It's good that we are working into this direction. And what I've seen with the new generation about how they feel this responsibility, I'm quite confident that we are going in the right one. Right direction.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bogdan. Thank you, Dan. If any other question? yeah. Eduarda, are you still in the call? Would you like to express your thoughts mentioned in the chat window about the reality in Brazil? Okay. Okay. Is there any other question? Okay, it seems like don't have more questions. Yeah, anyway. No other questions. Yeah, so Dan, it was a very interesting presentation, and the topic and the approach was quite new and fresh for most of us. I still think that we need a major breakthrough, a jump in the technology, especially on the energy production. Until then, we have to buy some time.
Yeah.
To buy some time and to do what we can, to transform these quick wins in buying time. So thank you for this presentation. Wants to meet again for the coming events, and hopefully we have the chance to meet face to face. Yeah, it seems like there is hope for the second half of the year. And yeah, thank you again. See you soon, and don't forget to claim the PDUs and to fill the survey that Julia mentioned in the chat window. Thanks again. See you soon.
Thank you. Thank you. Have a nice evening.
Have a nice evening. Bye-bye.
Thank you all. Bye-bye.